Subscribe to The Honest Critique for current affairs, movie, book, and product reviews. Also, make sure you press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video. The views, information, or opinions expressed during the video series are solely those of the individuals and do not necessarily represent those of The Honest Critique and its employees. The following video contains strong language which may be offensive to some viewers. Viewer discretion advised.
Okay, so today we are honored to have with us Mr. Vikram Sood. He was the former head of India's Foreign Intelligence Agency, the Research and Analysis Wing, and is currently an advisor to the Observer Research Foundation, an independent public policy think tank based out of New Delhi. Sir was an officer of the Indian Postal Service before he joined the intelligence wing, and later served as the spy master from 2000-2003. He retired as a career intelligence officer with 31 years service on 31st March 2003, and he trained under the mentorship of B. Raman, and he's author of the book The Unending Game, a former RAW chief's insight into espionage, published in 2018, which according to sir is a memoir, but not a beginner's guide to intelligence and espionage.
It's thank not you, a sir. Memoir.
Yeah. So thank you so much, sir. We are more than honored to have you among us today.
Thank you. It's great to be with you guys. I enjoy talking to the young. Because I think they listen to me more than the older ones do.
that's quite a setting. Yeah. All right. So so that's a great introduction, Ratnadeep. So I'll begin with the first question, sir. So when we talk about the intelligence apparatus of India, we come across various institutions such as the RNAW, the Intelligence Bureau, the NIA, etc. So there is a systematic process in which information is gathered and processed in an intelligence agency. If you could paint the picture of the process from the information received from the spies on the ground or the field officers to the policy makers taking action on it. So can you describe the whole process from ground zero to the headquarters in Delhi?
Well, it's actually a very long process. It can be a very intricate process. First, you have the human intelligence sources, whom we call HUMINT.
Okay.
That's the man on the ground. He is actually either got access to information or he knows somebody who has access, and that's how it works. Nowadays, you have a lot of information that comes from techint, from surveillance, from imagery, from communication intercepts, nowadays from email and social, everything. Everything that's up in the air is now subject to either intervention, interception, and use. So, to make a comprehensive report for the ultimate consumer, which is the government, a lot of things go into it, could go into one report. It could be based partly on what human sources told you. It's then backed up by something that another wing of the organization might have got from interceptions, on again backed with something that they've probably got from imagery, satellites. So, you know, you can have kinds and kinds of reports. It's not enough to say that my source told me this. Sometimes you need backups, you need confirmations. And unlike newspapers where you can shoot off a 2-hour debate on one gossip, our intelligence agencies can't afford that. You have to give information that is confirmed, reasonably reliable, or at least it's a warning that something is happening. But it's a very long, intricate, can be a long and intricate process of collecting. The most important thing in an intelligence setup is beginning from the gathering to the communication, to analysis, and then reporting to the government. So it's a process. Sometimes it is time bound. Sometimes it can be required to be done tomorrow or today or yesterday. So it's not one single process or one single kind of source.
Okay. So, sir, we have seen the craft of espionage from Chanakya's time, who has mentioned briefly in Arthashastra about the craft of espionage and why we need the craft of espionage in a kingdom. And you have briefly mentioned about the craft of espionage in World War and how it played a very important role. So for our viewers who might not understand what espionage is or why is espionage so important and how it played an important role in the history of World War, if you could summarize a bit of the history of espionage a bit.
Espionage, spying on foreign sources, foreign enemies. Actually, espionage is your first line of attack. It is there, it has to be there 24/7, 365 days. The army can do its exercises and rest for most of the year. Thankfully, they are not involved fighting wars all the time. But espionage goes on all the time. And in fact, espionage, if you want to develop your espionage rings, if you want to develop your sources, the best time to do it is peacetime. Because when the hot war starts, you're going to be very silly just hunting for sources then. Because they might have fled too or dead. So the best way to start an intelligence game is to start it in peacetime. And even friendly countries are not out of range. Okay. So there is no such thing as I will not, you may all say we don't do it, but it is common practice. So, I mean, the French have spied on us, the British have done it, the Americans have done it, the Russians have done it, and we've had friendly relations with them. So that's par for the course. So unless you are forewarned, unless you know the intentions of the enemy, unless you know the capabilities, how are you going to counter him? And these days it is going to be more and more technology oriented, artificial intelligence oriented. I don't fancy too many hot wars of the Second World War kind erupting now. It's far too expensive, far too destructive. So the tendency would be to go into artificial intelligence, cyber attacks, cyber warfare. And that's what we would be looking at. Second World War was different. It was a gruesome hot war of statistics and numbers being killed or to be killed, and attacks that came through what we now call conventional weapons. So the whole game has changed now. It's not the same thing.
All right, sir. That was a pretty interesting historical insight into the world of espionage. So for the next question, sir, being a career intelligence officer in the RNAW, so do you think the RNAW needs to become more like the Central Intelligence Agency of the United States and move away from the IS-IPS or the bureaucratic batch of officers and catch the officers young and have a more transparent recruitment process? Do we need a shift of recruitment or a shift of indictment of the officers in the top cadre of the RNAW?
You know, I've been writing about it quite often in the past. Talked about intelligence reforms, the need for reforms, and what kind of reforms, you know. And my thrust has been that you have to prepare for the future. So governments need to assess where we would be in 30 years, maybe. Just take a time span of a particular period, because 30 years is also the normal lifespan of an officer in a service. 30, 35. So you think of where you would be 30 years from now, where the world will be 30 years from now, and then plan accordingly. assessment being whether we have today the capabilities, whether we will in 30 years from now have the capability to provide the government information that we need. So we have to start preparing from now onwards. We can't turn around in 30 years from now and say, I don't have the manpower, I don't have the skills to do it. So we have to start now. Because it takes X number of years to get a man trained for the job. And therefore, the kind of skills that you need are not available with the normal routine civil services. I don't mean it as a criticism of the service. They may be very intelligent and hardworking. But you need special skills now. You need men and women who will be good at economics, at technology, at cyber, chemicals, languages. You need any number of language experts. You need not just chaps who will sit and translate for you in the desk, at the desk at home. You need people who will be able to speak that language and that dialect of the target country. It's not enough to know Urdu to go to Pakistan. You have to be able to speak that kind of Urdu. Or Chinese, or Tibetan, or Russian. So this is where we will always be lacking behind unless we start to recruit young. I would even go to the extent of saying, like in the army, one should now start thinking of recruiting after school graduation. You know, nowadays boys and girls are 18 or 19 when they finish from school, quite often. We were 16 when we joined college. And then we didn't even shave. Now you have grown-up men who are voters, who go and cast their ballots, and then they join college. So they're old enough to come to a training institute which will then give them the kind of skills you need, like the army does. You have an engineer, you have infantryman, you have an armored corps fellow. So you have these kinds of skills to be imparted in your training academies, which could be a 2-3 year course. And that's what we should be aiming at. When there was this regular service in the RAW, we had that system. They were trained for 3 years. 2.5-3 years, but nowadays I suppose it's different. So unless you have committed, trained people in the service, that amount of professionalism will not be there. You cannot run an intelligence service only on the by inducting officers temporarily from other services, taking them on for X number of years, 10 years, 12 years, then they go back. So that they've come to you, they've imbibed your secrets, they've learned everything, and just when they are good enough to deliver, they go back home for a better opportunity in their own service. Who gains from this? The intelligence organization does not gain from this. In fact, periodically it loses talent. So you have to have, you know, like other services, the British, the Russians, the all of them, they have committed people who are the core. You could have temporarily experts coming in for a couple of years who specially skilled for a particular project and then they go back. But you can't have that import of talent on a regular basis. It has to be homegrown. So, yeah, we have to move in that direction. How the bureaucracy will take it, whether it will allow it or not, because a lot of the bureaucracy is about control, not delivery. So,
okay, sir.
Yeah, that's it.
All right, sir. So, about the intra-departmental issues, having outsiders at the top level of in the agency, because RNAW hires officers from a lot of different cadres also, including the IBN, etc. So having outsiders at the top level of the agency has not been a good idea suggested by some retired officers. How does that affect the morale of the serving officers of the department?
You know, every rookie who joins the service hopes to reach the top. Well, that's a normal desire, normal ambition, but someday I am good enough to be heading the organization. But if he feels that his career is limited up to only a particular level, beyond that somebody else will come, it is a limiting factor. It is a limiting factor to your commitment. You know that, well, if I'm not going to make it to the top despite my talent, so why don't I try my luck somewhere else? A chief of an organization, why doesn't the army have somebody outsiders coming in? Why don't the railways do it? Why doesn't the Air Force have an army general heading them? This is an organization that needs particular skills, that needs particular ethos, that needs a particular understanding of how the system works. And it's a very complicated system of checks and balances, of need to know and how to deal with different parts of the entire organization. So it needs somebody who has that, who's grown in the service, who spent his life there. So I don't see how somebody coming in from outside is going to be the best thing. But what is happening in the services is that people do come from the police service, stay on for 20 years, and then they are considered as having belonging to the service, and then assume that they will head the organization. My point is a little different. My point is you recruit them into the service at the beginning for total commitment. Not take them on deputation after they've done 7, 8, 10 years. Then they work with you with the option of going back whenever they want to go back. The drawback in all this, what I'm suggesting, is that if you have a person who's not good, who's not going to make beyond a particular grade, it can happen. It can always happen. Or he's rendered unemployable because he's been exposed as an intelligence officer, and he cannot therefore function anymore, or some misconduct. How do you sideline him? In many services, you know, you send off a chap to an innocuous post somewhere else, and he stays there till retirement, and then he's quietly faded out. What do you do with these guys? So that has to be worked out, where you give him a golden handshake, as they call. Give you severance money of an agreed amount, depending on what he's done, and then sign him off with a note saying that if you reveal something, then you there will be consequences. So we have to get out of this groove of chalta hai, recruit kar liya, acha ladka hai. You know, he was very good. He topped in the IAS or IFS, although they don't come to us. But he was a good officer. Fine, he's a good officer, no doubt. But then, does he have the skills to match? Does he have aptitude to match? Is he always going to be very introverted and stay at home? You can't have an intelligence officer who does that. Or he's not prepared to take a risk. He's not a gambler. You know, 1 in 50 cases succeeds in the intelligence. If you target 50 people, you might get one. And how do you target a man or a woman as your source? Ko likha to hai nahi ki I am willing to be recruited. You have a task that you want to recruit somebody in the nuclear establishment. So you find out who's working in the establishment. Then you try and find out where they live. Who is the possible vulnerable target among them? How do you determine that? आपके पास पहले तो लिस्ट होनी चाहिए ना, कौन कौन है, वेयर दे लिव, वेयर दे स्टडी. यू नो इट्स अ ह्यूजली लेबोरियस टास्क रिक्रूटिंग एजेंट्स, एंड मेनी वेरी ऑफन डिस्पाइट इंटेलिजेंस एजेंसीज बीइंग वेरी वेरी ऑफ इट, मेनी ऑफ द इंटेलिजेंस रिक्रूट्स दैट द सोवियट्स हैड और द अमेरिकन्स हैड ड्यूरिंग वर्ल्ड वॉर एंड द कोल्ड वॉर were walk-ins. They came and offered intelligence. It wasn't that Gordievsky was recruited by the British. No. He insisted on being recruited. He was so desperate about his country's behavior. He offered himself. So that's how it works. And if you can't recruit in peacetime, as I mentioned earlier, you can't really recruit in wartime. And now in the kind of situations we are, the sooner we do all this, the better it would be for us.
That's right.
So, sir, in the book you mentioned that training of raw officers anticipating the future, while judging the present as one continues to remember the past, can quite be the task for even the most highly trained agent and analyst. So presently, this is training period of approximately 6 months, a period that is kind of insufficient probably for them to hone their final skills required for espionage. Do you think RAW needs a huge reform in the training process as well?
I think I've just been saying that I don't know what the present process is of how they recruit. I'm only giving what I think is the ideal, I may be wrong, what may be the ideal training requirement of an intelligence, for an intelligence officer. And I think 2 to 3 years of the grind is very necessary. It has to be a tough training on mental agility. You have to train him in skills. He's not come born with the skills of recruiting or evading surveillance or mounting surveillance or collecting data, information. You know, even the skill of detailed reading is a skill. Many of us think we've read the whole page, but we probably haven't. You know, you assume this is what he has said. He may not have said that. Instead of but, he might have said if, but you simply said that. So these are things that you have to learn. We were taught, you know, you've shown a room and there are 25 items lying there. Given 2 minutes, have a look, go out and tell us what was there. You start with those simple skills. And you find that, you know, you think you've seen everything, you know everything, but you don't. And then an intelligence officer needs much more than just academic qualifications. He needs skills of the world. He needs skills to be able to, you know, there is a particular aptitude of listening to a source, what he said, and reproducing what he has said faithfully. What happens with most of us is, we've heard him, then we put in our words in it. Unconsciously, not deliberately, but it might change the whole context. So these are skills that only an intelligence training institute plus on the ground, on the job training for a few years will impart. I would think that an intelligence officer is ready to provide good intelligence after 10 to 15 years of the grind. So if you recruit him at 25 or 28 after the civil service exam, so you got 32 years. He retired at 60. He spends 10 years learning the trade, getting skillful in delivering results to you. And another 20 years, he's gone. So you actually got man in service for 20 years. out of which the last 10 or 15 will be spent on the desk, not collecting intelligence. Because he's now old, senior. He doesn't want to do dirty his hands anymore.
So what you're pointing out here is that we need to pick them up when they're in the molding period, when they are young and molding, around 18 or something or around that.
You guys are just about missing the grade in my book. Graduates. You're safe. You're safe. So, intelligence in the, generally speaking, in the West is an honorable job. It's a job for the country because they know the importance. They've been through the world wars, so they know how important intelligence is. I don't think we have that kind of... it is coming, but it is more kind of... awe of the unknown, which is different from actually wanting to work there. Yeah, I like the organization, but you work, I'm not joining you. The desire to join is now I can see among youngsters like you guys, some of you, who say, how do we join? And I'm on Twitter, so many people ask me, sir, we want to join, how do we do it? So I have to give the usual reply, you go to the civil survey, da da da, and so on. So that's how it is. Because want to take, if somebody recruits me as directly, and then after 3, 10 years, 15 years, either I'm found incompetent or I turn a rogue. Then the guy who's recommended me, recruited me, will be asked, you recommended him, why did you recommend him? So nobody wants to do that. We want to all play safe. Mainu ki, mujhe kya hai, karo jo karna hai. So we have to get out of this, post-event witch hunt. We still have people who, former coal secretaries are hauled over the courts after 10 years of retirement for something they wrote or said on the file. So we have to, either a man is good then or became bad later is different from he was a bad then and bad now.
So, sir, what's the role of a spy master in the entire recruitment process, how it works? What was your role, kind of? Were you also involved in the process in some way or the other?
Recruitment? Well...
Recruitment.
Recruitment of agents or spy, others, people who will spy?
So the agent.
I mean, what was your job as a spy master?
People who work in the RAW are not the guys who go around cracking safes or stealing information like James Bond does. Okay? That's not it. These guys have people who will do it for them. You might have the odd man who's required for safe, for unopening safe, but that's a different reason. But you don't provide all these skills to an intelligence officer so that he can go into the intelligence organization's headquarters and crack their safes, pick out information and come away. It doesn't happen like that. So we were all involved in recruiting other officers to the organization at different scale periods of one's career. You were either at the stage in a member of a board which was recruiting, or you were heading a board, or finally taking a decision above the board. So I went through all these three stages of picking up people and bringing them in. And so that's how it goes. it's a normal, it's a fairly common procedure.
It's like HR of any other company.
Yeah. You get their dossiers, you have a look at them, you call them for a meeting. We used to have exams also at one time. Then psychological profiles. So it's a part of the system.
All right. So can you tell us about the role of RNAW in terms of counterterrorism tactics and counterinsurgency tactics? And do you think it has changed over the years with an adapted responsibility of internal security? And contemporary to that, how advanced is RNAW in terms of intelligence gathering?
Difficult question, because the past I will not tell you. The present I don't know. All right.
Yeah. Yes, sir. That's well noted. But in a brief comparative way, if you can relate RNAW to the closest of its sister organizations.
I can tell you how the system matters of principle.
Yeah.
You see, when I joined service in the 70s, early 70s, there was no terrorism of the kind that we see today. We had insurgency. We had the Naga insurgency, the Mizo insurgency in the Northeast. Then we started having the Naxals. The Naxal had started by then. So this is all that was. There was no jihadi terrorism. There was no. Naxals were local with some bit of support from the Chinese. Chinese are supporting the Nagas and later to the Mizos for a while. But that was the limited insurgency. But now it's really global. The tie-ups are global. Everything has gone global. What has not gone global really the way Islamist terrorism has is that until 2001, until September 11, I used to keep saying that the terrorists have gone global, counterintelligence must go global, but it really didn't happen. It was my terrorist versus yours. My terrorist is better than yours.
So are you talking about joint corporation of intelligence? Joint cooperation?
Yeah.
All right.
So because if you are international terrorism, you must have international cooperation. Now, how can you have cooperation with Pakistan? We stopped there. That's where it was emanating from. How do we get intelligence from them? The others are not, they are not affected by the same terrorism. So their priorities are different. They're not going to spend their valuable manpower or resources on a threat that is not theirs. So you had that other limiting factor. Then there is always the political decision whether you want to help India or not, whether you want to help Pakistan or not, whether you want to save Pakistan. And or otherwise. So those are issues that kept coming up all the time. It's only later, now that you have this institutions or mechanism like the FATF that is tightening.
I was about to come to that in the later part, the Financial Action Task Force, because recently it has been very much in the news because of the Dawood Ibrahim connection and everything.
Yeah,
that would be in the later part, so we will discuss it more, okay. A little bit in more detail.
Okay.
So, sir, in the book you mentioned that information is increasingly the key, and the one who gets the narrative right first is usually the winner. And you've also spoken about information warfare in the book, and stressed that it's the one who gets the story out first gets an advantage.
Yeah.
So with the present scenario, any attack on Pakistan by militia, is termed as an attack initiated from RNAW.
Yeah.
How do you see covert actions being affected by propaganda warfare? Does the twin formula that you mentioned in the book of necessary lie and plausible deniability still works in the present scenario?
You know, it also depends on circumstances. I think plausible deniability is still relevant. It's a game that the target country or your enemy country understands. We understand, the rest of the world understands. Nobody, if you can plausibly deny an action, nobody wants to do anything after that. There are occasions when you don't want to be plausibly deniable. Balakot was not a it was not a deniable action. It was an action that you wanted to do it. Actually, Uri, in my opinion, should have been a plausibly deniable action. You do it, but don't own up. You have to send a message, therefore you owned up. Now, getting your information in first, your story in first, is relevant because anything else you say after that is a defense. You know, you come and accuse me of doing something which I haven't done, then I just go around trying to defend myself. No, I didn't do it, so-and-so did it. Isi to bolta hai. So your story has to get in first. And you might want to, when the book comes out, I've written another book, so it will be out next month. So it's about narratives and how globally narratives are played. And that's where you will get an idea how this game is. It's how deniability or plausible deniability or getting your narrative in first is a huge part of is a huge weapon in your hands in the global interplay of power equations. You know, you want to give your story of superiority and maintain it. How do you do that?
So in terms of in a very layman terms, sir, if something goes wrong, as you have always said that you know the RNAW because of its failure, but not because of its successes. And I think that is a very remarkable statement which is suitable for the intelligence community. So please talk about the terms people, usually the civilian population, use when they say intelligence failure or when the dots are not connected. How do such intelligence failures occur? How do we fail to see connect the dots in certain times of crisis?
Several things happen, actually. You have no report at all about an incident. That's one kind of failure. You have information which is totally with you, but you do not communicate. That is another failure. You have information which is half. That's the third kind of failure. The fourth failure is you have all the information. You've passed it on to the people. You've passed it on over several days. You know, bit by bit, you've told them this. Nothing happens. Because somewhere in the system, they have not connected the dots. We report that we saw troops massing at point A. We report that tanks have moved in. We report something has happened on the Eastern Front. We report airports being alerted. But nobody takes notice of all this. Unless you connect the dot. Then if the action starts, everybody says, there was no intelligence. Of course, there was no intelligence about point A or B, but we told you that this is how they're building up, so you take your measures, your countermeasures. So intelligence failures do happen. But they are not all intelligence failures. I think Kargil, I maintain, was a systemic failure. It was not a failure. Mumbai 2611. It was inadequate intelligence, admittedly, but the rest of it.
Can you talk about the relationship between different institutions, such as the RNAW with the IB, RNAW with the Army or Navy, or et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah.
Because some people often say that these institutions do not gel within themselves.
Well, it's like this. If you are living in America, you would enjoy watching the kind of animosity there used to be, probably still is, between the FBI and the CIA. There is always going to be a competitive edge to this. It becomes lethal when the top guys don't get along. That's a human factor in all of this. First, it is competition, particularly when this feeling is that the RAW is the more glamorous outfit. You know, you get to go abroad, and you live abroad, and you do fancy things. This poor guy at home is only going to deal with what's going to happen in some remote part of India somewhere and pick up some local agents. And, you know, it's a different kind of world that they imagine we live in. That happens. The other is, I think, institutional disdain. So there is rivalry, there is disdain at times. The RAW chap probably feels that the naval guy or the Air Force guy doesn't understand what we're doing. They don't pay attention. The Air Force chap will say, they don't give us adequate information. So ye to chalega, ye to, we have to live and deal with it. We've had very good relations. We've had IBRAW had very good relations, and there have been times when they were not so good. So there is no cure for it. There is no magic pill for this. It's professional.
So, sir, at times what happens is that, in fact, when an incident like Pulwama happens, as Siddhant was mentioning, the general sentiment is the term that's been used called an intelligence failure. Probably, as you mentioned, point A, intercept has been given and an intelligence has been provided to the policymakers. But since RNAW's point of view has, or the intelligence community's point of view does not go to the media, it's always the policymaker will listen to. And at times to cover their own back, a lot of this blame has come to intelligence community. Does it feel a need to share your side of the narrative at times?
No. We are the fall guys. We accept the thing. Because if I were to turn around and defend that genuinely, I'll have to reveal my sources. I'll have to say, no, we had this information from this person. Because the next question is, how do you know? Then I have to tell them how I know. I just can't afford it. I'll just accept it. Take care. As long as the government knows, as long as the people who are receiving the information know that there was information, that's enough. Intelligence agencies will not engage. So, intelligence failure, bolte rahiye, theek hai.
Quite well. We'll move on to a topic which you've spoken a lot in the last 1 year. It's about Kashmir. you've said once Article 370 should have been removed long back, but the road ahead is not easy. Now, it's been a year since the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A. So what's your assessment of this past 1 year have been? Because we have not seen a lot of narrative that's come up from the valley. And do you think India was lagging a bit in information and psychological warfare, in controlling and shaping of the international media? In fact, a couple of months before also, but just before the lockdown ended, documentary crew went to Kashmir and shot a video series on the entire Article 370 application, which is against probably India's, if I could use the word interest, the national interest. This information warfare has been going on for a very long time, and you have also spoken about how we have not been able to shape the narrative well. Do you think we were successful in how we shaped the narrative in the past 1 year as well?
I think you've done a pretty good job. You know, when all these political leaders were arrested, how many Kashmiris protested? When they were released, how many celebrated? So, that is a yardstick to tell you that these are the guys who would relied on this article for themselves. They did not wish to lose this. They used it as a leverage with a lazy system that existed in New Delhi. You know, these are the people who will support you and defend you. And Article 370, it's a temporary legislation brought in. And how can temporary thing become permanent? And 35A was also even unconstitutional. It did not go through the parliament. It went through an executive order. And we lived with this myth for 70 years. You can't have two constitutions. You can't have two flags. You can have a party flag, theka, you can carry your own Congress party flag and all those sort of. You can even have a state, but you can't have constitutionally have another flag. You can't have a constitution which says I will have election on 6 years and laws passed by the Delhi legislature, central legislature, are subject to approval by the Kashmir legislature. What kind of federalism was that? Things, you know, Dal Lake has been, you know, small things have happened. Dal Lake is being cleared now in 70 years. What does a Kashmir, what does an average person want? Roti, kapda, makan, yaar. Other things come later. Of course, you must have freedom, you must have all that. Granted. But if you're going to give him nothing and expect support, then you won't get support. How many people have, how many terrorists have been killed in the last 1 year?
I think the number is pretty high, sir.
And let me also tell you, when numbers of incidents increase, it doesn't necessarily mean that terrorism is increased. It merely means that the engagements have increased. When numbers decline, it does not mean that terrorism has ended. You have to have other indications. You have to know whether recruitment has stopped, whether the ideological movements have stopped. Because no action means they are probably regrouping. They're taking a breather. You talk of peace, they take a breather. And they come back after 6 months.
Yeah. So what you are saying is these developments that have happened on the operational front, that we have been able to hunt down the militants and terrorists and kill them, these numbers have been explosively high in the last 1 year, I would rather say particularly. So, but parallel to that, experts have also suggested that there is a desperate need of reviving the political process in the valley and winning the hearts and minds of the Kashmiri population. So, do you think that we need a fresh policy beyond the existing muscular policy of the government, which is the Operation All Out. I mean, these are small tactical gains, but for the longer run, do we need a concrete policy to revive the political process, or should we continue with the same?
There is a point there. Well, it's a question of timing. Whether it is the time is now right that we should move in for alternative, whether we should wait for alternative opinion to grow on its own. And it would be best if it is allowed to grow on its own, not left to, others encouraging birth of a new party. It doesn't last very long. Then you're labeled as a Sarkari party, Sarkari politician. That doesn't help. So let them find their own way. They will. And 1 year after 70 years is not too much time here. You need a little more time for things to normalize, people to take. Terrorists had the benefits all along, monetarily, and they were running the roost, ruling the roost. The politicians were making money. The intermediary was making money. They were having the profits of war, as it were. The janta, the common man, must now see the profits of peace. So if you can deliver on ground, peace, tranquility, his needs are taken care of, he feels safe, that's a great victory. Politics can come later, but first you have the common man say thank you. Then the politician, the clever politician, will take advantage and say, I did it for you, so be it. So let him then be part of the system. You will then fight elections for a part which is now constitutionally, legally part of India. And it will have the same law as the rest of the country. I think we're doing pretty okay. Of course, there are doubters around who feel that anything this government does is wrong. So, we'll see. I think we're on the right track.
Yeah. So, this question comes from a perspective that me and Siddhant both comes from a university which helps us to interact with a lot of other students from around the state. And we have seen a lot of students from Kashmir speak to us on the fact there's a certain sense of alienation they feel from the rest of India as such. Do we think in our attempt, we have not really reached out to them in a way that we can assure them that it's not a certain sense of alienation, it's more that we are trying to bind it together, both the state of Kashmir and the rest of India? How can we reduce the sense of alienation? Because this sense of alienation may lead later on to take up arms, as we've seen a lot of young children pick up guns there.
It's
I'll just add one more thing. So with a sense of alienation, we have also seen a lot of people have lost trust in the political process in the valley as well. How we can make sure that these political leaders that we are asking them to contest election actually does have the hope of people out there and they actually go and vote?
You know, if you were to join the government service or even the private sector, there is a process. They ask you questions, they check your certificates. In the government, they do character and antecedents verification. They see your graduation records to assess how your behavior up to that particular date has been. We don't have any such process for politicians. Okay, so a politician can be whatever. He just has to contest elections. So to find a right kind of politician who will help you run the country only grows from among the people. He doesn't come from anywhere else. And that is a self-generating process. So good politicians are a matter of luck. Some people say Trump is very good, others don't. So that is how you are fated. Alienation is, that is, it's true. It is there. And it is unfortunate. But then what do you expect after 70 years? Three generations have been affected. At least. So it will not disappear overnight. Some will take their entire lifetime. Some will recover sooner. Some may never recover. So alienation will not go away. It's not a Article 370 or whatever action government takes. These are not magic pills. These are only steps towards that. As more and more Kashmiris come out, as more and more of them find either jobs or business or trade outside the country, they will find that the average Indian is not anti them. There are Kashmiris who I know are flourishing in Goa. There are Kashmiris in Delhi who are doing pretty well. And I'm talking about Kashmiri Muslims. Kashmiri Pandits have had a rough time. They've also managed to get on with life, most of them. But that hurt is there. If you talk of alienation of the Muslim Kashmiri, think of the Kashmiri Pandit who belonged to Kashmir before Islam came there. And he was thrown out of the valley. And we said nothing. We said absolutely nothing. We put them in those hovels and dirty camps in Jammu and forgot all of them in the name of secularism. So when you look at Kashmir, don't think in terms of the Kashmiri Muslim alone. There are only four districts in the Kashmir Valley which have been affected by this. They're not in Ladakh, not in Kargil, not in Jammu, Katwa. So we can't let this four be allowed to determine what's going to happen in the rest of the state, much less the country. True, they have suffered. But the rest of the Kashmiris didn't raise a banner against them that they will throw you out. They went to Pakistan to get help. And they went to get help because a chief minister of that time so rigged the elections that obvious winners were defeated. How do you think Syed Salahuddin was born? Because he was winning that election, I don't remember where, and till the last minute, and then the results were declared that he had lost. And he went and joined Hizbul Mujahideen. This was the time of Farooq Abdullah. So we ourselves created this kind of a situation. 89, who was the Home Minister in Delhi?
Mufti Saab.
Mufti Saeed. His daughter is kidnapped.
Yeah. Rubaiya Saeed.
Rubaiya was kidnapped. Some people even doubt that whether she was actually kidnapped. And then we released four of their JKLF terrorists. Ghulam Nabi Azad's nephew was picked up. For them also we released. Yasin is another guy. You called Yasin Malik a moderate. He killed four IA personnel and we called him a moderate.
Air Force officer, yeah.
Yeah. We called him, he should have been locked up. So,
letters are written now to United Nations to release him.
Yes.
Letters are written to United Nations to release him.
We allowed all that to happen. We ourselves fed into this alienation by giving them the status of heroes. They shot dead this man's father, Mirwais's father.
Mirwais, yeah. He was the Mirwais that time, particularly.
That time. Mm-hmm. Till date, his son hasn't blamed Hizbul Mujahideen.
Yeah. So, we let these
Huriyat chaps come and meet the Pakistani High Commission. Then we say, we're alienate ho gaye. We're feeding into it. You revolting against my country, I have an entitled to take action. My book is quite simple.
Yeah. So, sir,
you can have what your religion you may be, you whatever caste, nothing matters. You revolt against the flag, I will not take it.
Yeah. So, sir, now since Jammu and Ladakh are union territories, the security aspects haven't been mentioned much and not been out there in public domain. There's a sense of relief among Ladakhi population who were alienated due to the presence of Article 370, as much of the tension was going to the valley itself.
Yeah.
So how do you see the future of Ladakh's look like right now?
Less the Chinese, I think it's pretty bright. I think they will come into their own now. The Ladakhis, to my past knowledge, are an intensely Indian patriotic lot. They don't have any two opinions on that. So everything will be all right. Young men, we'll all do well in the end. We have our own ways of doing it, slow and lethargic, but we get there. So, Kashmir is a problem that Pakistan doesn't know how to handle. And Kashmiri terrorism without Pakistani support cannot survive. So, unless the Pakistanis think of some other way of doing it, I don't see this problem aggravating.
I'm glad you brought out Pakistan here, because that was going to be the next question, and I think that's it's a common obsession in us. We all Indians have this particular obsession with Pakistan, and you have denied that we shouldn't talk to Pakistan in any way unless there is a change in heart. Your former colleagues and somehow your previous officers have somehow suggested in various capacities that we should engage in talks with Pakistan. How can we assess that there is a change in heart of Pakistan, or they are making some welcoming noises that we should engage in conversation with Pakistan?
Good question. The thing is, you have to understand the Pakistani mindset of how they deal with themselves. Hamari baat chhodiye. How they deal among themselves with themselves. And you get an indication that if a person is so intolerant of Shias, Ahmadis, the way they treat minorities, the way they treat each other, the manner in which they are prepared to go and declare another person blasphemous because he's not practicing their kind of religion, how is he going to talk to me? And this is happening more and more in Pakistan. as they go down the slope is getting worse. It is not my business to rescue Pakistan. It is for Pakistan to rescue Pakistan. If he is going to be tolerant of his own people, he might be tolerant of us. If he is going to talk less of Kashmir and more of other things, it will happen. He is not prepared to give you MFN. He is not prepared to... The only treaty they want to adhere to is the Indus waters. Nothing else, because that suits them. The rest of it doesn't matter. And for Pakistan, the main fear is not that they will lose Kashmir. The main fear is not, the main desire is not to get Kashmir because it's Muslim. The main desire is to get Kashmir because the waters of the Punjab flow through Kashmir. They fear that the Indians will one day knock that off. The waters of Chenab, Indus, and Satluj. If we knock them, Satluj. If we knock them off, then they starve. So it is, that is driving them. And they can't drive anything else but using Islam for that. So where do we talk to them? On what? बात करें किस बात पे बात करें यू कांट टेक कश्मीर फ्रॉम मी आई एम नॉट गिविंग यू कश्मीर व्हाट आर यू गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट यू नो दैट इज द लाइन आई एंट गिविंग इट टू यू बडी यू एंट गेटिंग इट सो They have to come to terms. They have to learn to live with a bigger neighbor who has no intentions of occupying them. God help us. I'm not interested in having an inch of Pakistani territory. I don't need it. I don't desire it. So what is the problem? You have to learn to live with a bigger neighbor. We have to learn to live with China. We are the smaller neighbor.
All right. Yeah.
So, sir, just wanted to ask what you're what you're talking about is, do you somewhat mean that the other side cannot be a dove in this case when the other side is being a hawk? A hawk and a dove relation cannot exist in this scenario we're talking about. Do we need to change the way we approach the issue with Pakistan?
You know, I do believe that the rest of the world respects you if you stand up for your rights. If our neighbors see that we are all the time giving in concessions to our other neighbors, and that we are not able to defend our interests, why would they come to you? If they know that we are not able to stand up to China, they're not going to come to us for assistance. If they know that Pakistan can get concessions from us by terrorism, then we are a soft state. Both ways. So you have to be able to stand up to the bigger one, and you have to tell the smaller neighbor that I'm not going to harm you, I'm not going to hurt you, but I will not tolerate violation of my rights.
So in that case, sir, do the Indian side look at Balochistan and the Pashtun Tahaffuz movement or the insurgency going on the Northwest frontier provinces as a vantage point, as a tactical plus point for us?
I hope they do.
And are we doing something?
I have no idea.
Have we done something?
I can't tell you.
All right, sir. All right. So yeah, perfect. So this is one of my very favorite topic, and it has been very close to my heart. Afghanistan has always been a very important part of my work in the last couple of years. So so these days, as we are seeing the intra-Afghan dialogues and the peace process taking place, recently the Loya Jirga was concluded in Kabul, and we heard a lot of, and there was an assassination attempt also, which was made on one of the lady member of the High Peace Council. So with America will be gone soon from Afghanistan, and Pakistan undoubtedly has an upper hand in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. So we had a long history being involved in Afghanistan, from funding the Northern Alliance to building infrastructure to economic development and so trading the ANSM as well. So where does mm-hmm. India stand now in Afghanistan, and what are our self-interests in Afghanistan?
Self-interest in Afghanistan. You know, the whole world is in a churn these days. The Chinese have moved in a big way. Chinese have moved into Pakistan much more strongly. And both China and Pakistan would not tolerate too much Indian involvement in Afghanistan. The Chinese are also getting closer to Iran. So we are going to be left out rather alone in Afghanistan. The Americans will leave. The Taliban are not known to be friendly towards us. So our choices are getting more and more limited. We don't have the capacities, military or economic, to sustain the kind of support to Afghanistan to meet the kinds of needs that they need, that they want. The Chinese can do it better. They have more money. They are more concerned.
There has been a very
route through Pakistan. So, and the Chinese will go all out to get a route from Xinjiang through Tajikistan, Afghanistan into Iran, bypassing Pakistan if required. If Pakistan goes more and more Islamic and theocratic, they may prefer to have this route to the Gulf. So we are up against a huge reconfiguration of the geopolitical situation in Afghanistan. Whether the Afghans will remain friendly with us, whether the Pashtun movement becomes a greater Pashtunistan movement or a greater Afghanistan movement is to be seen, shall I say. And whether it ties up with the Baloches or it's separate, I don't know. The only access one has to these places are through a chaotic Afghanistan, for which you have to go through Iran, which is also not too friendly these days. So,
Urgence, there is some level of hurry between regional powers in order to talk to Taliban. And with the whole Qatar episode, cracking the US withdrawal deal with Taliban, Taliban has been given a lot of legitimacy. So does India require to talk to Pakistan in a sense which gives them a legitimacy and to be ahead in the race?
Talk to the Taliban, you mean?
Yeah.
Theoretically, that makes sense that, you know, they are the power that will determine the future, it seems. So you have to deal with the guy who is guarding the door. And you can't escape that. But and let's not go into the ethics of it or whatever. This is the reality of the on the ground. So yes, I think ultimately we will have to do it. If you want to stay in Afghanistan, whether you like the regime or not, and the regime's attitude is not going to change towards Islam or anything else, they're going to be the same. So main keh raha tha ki, you know, you have to decide whether you want to be holy and stay away from them, or want to be practical and deal with them. Because I don't think the Taliban are going to change their way of looking at the world, or at themselves, or at their own people. The point also is, what is the strategic advantage for us in dealing with Afghanistan if Afghanistan is not going to be on your side? Can we turn them around? Or do we just want to be in Afghanistan because everybody else is there? Can we leave Afghanistan, which is a member of the SAARC? SAARC being dead more or less anyway. So you have to geostrategically, geopolitically decide what is your advantage in staying on. What is the price you're going to pay for it? And price can be in terms of human lives. They've done it in the past. The Pakistanis can unleash the Haqqani network on you. Are we going to send only ITBP, or are we going to send troops there? Would the Taliban accept our troops there? No, I don't think so. Not after the Americans have gone and the Taliban are under the sway of the Pakistanis. So Taliban choices are getting starker and starker. Much though you may want to help the Afghans, I don't know how we are going to be able to do it.
Yes, so let's come to the point that this has been the news for the last 2-3 months right now. That's the India-China face-off. You have stressed the India-China face-off that happened in the Galwan Valley.
Huh.
Yeah. So you have stressed upon the fact that China is a bigger threat than Pakistan, and we need to pay more attention to China if we want to become a bigger power in the region and beyond. Mm-hmm. So what are the risks that are emerging from China which brings you to that conclusion? It's the first point. And the second one is, a lot of experts have, like so-called experts have mentioned that this face-off was one of the face-off that happened was one of the point that Mr. Amit Shah made in one of the speeches, that the Indian government is looking at POK as well. And we know that the Belt Road Initiative passes through Gilgit-Baltistan, and China has huge investment in that. Is this insecurity comes from there? Does this attack happen? And is Arunachal Pradesh going to be the next flashpoint in anytime soon?
China has never been your friend, right from day one. Mao Zedong wasn't particularly enamored of us. And ever since Dalai Lama crossed over, the relationship was bound to sour. So, 59 onwards, it became like that.
Hello.
And if 50, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, sir.
From 63, the Pakistanis handed over Shakskam to China, Northern Kashmir. And to me, since then, we have been in a two-front war with terrorism from one side and pressure from the other. The border may have been quiet with China for years, in the sense that we don't have cross-border terrorism, there are no flare-ups, you know, cross-border firings. But it hasn't changed their attitude. The game is quite simple. They come, push forward, make that the new line, and say, now we'll negotiate from here. Because we have ourselves admitted somewhere that the LSE is a line of perception. Perceptions vary where exactly the LSE is. So they say, this is where it is. Now we come to Galwan, tomorrow they'll move forward again, you know, creeping forward, inching forward. You ask why I think China is a greater threat than Pakistan. What can Pakistan do to us? Create terror? What can China do to you? It can surround you and change your way of life. And it is in the process. It doesn't happen overnight. It happens, takes decades. And unless we wake up and do countermeasures, you know, you may feel very, we may sort of take some kind of a pleasure that Sri Lankans had a raw deal because RAWD, not RNAW. Raw deal with China on the Hambantota thing, they had to give that port away to China. I mean, that's what they wanted. And they've got it. They've got Hambantota as a port for to be used in their geopolitical ambitions. They've got that. They've got Gwadar. They've got the Gulf. They've got Djibouti. They're moving forward. And we have been a kind of a continental power without realizing that you have a huge coastline to defend. We've imagined threats either from the northwest or northeast. We've done absolutely nothing in the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea for a long time. It's now beginning to happen, but these things have long gestation periods. So that is going to be a problem for India. And economically, they can hurt you. Pakistan doesn't hurt you economically. But China can. If Pakistanis were clever, they would trade with us and get benefits. But they're not clever, so it's all right. The Chinese are clever. They're taking your resources away and giving you junk. So they're doing it, and we're happy that we've got 60 billion trade with Chinese. Most of it, you're giving them your precious raw materials, and they're giving you plastic and buckets and stuff, a little bit of infrastructure. So, and how can you retaliate against China? You have to do two or three things. You have to defend, your defense preparedness has to change. Your economic, you have to have some kind of an economic miracle. Minus all the babudum that is going on. And thirdly, you got to have your narrative. So, China is the big one. And it has, it is an unscrupulous one.
That's right. So I was coming to the narrative part of it, because you also said that your new book is about to be about narrative and different narratives. So here I would like to talk about Kashmir, sir, because often what we have realized is that India as a state have often failed to realize the rationale for radicalization in Kashmir. And the rationale for radicalization is not just restricted to alienation, it is also based on theology. For example, if a man from Kerala goes to Syria or Iraq, it is not just for, there is no alienation. Alienation is not the rationale for such a transition. So what I'm saying is, what is the counter narrative that we have to build here to combat that kind of radicalization, which is emerging not just from theology, but also from alienation, a sense of desperation, etc., whatever.
You know, it's a very difficult situation. Radicalization is something that happens, can happen to anyone anytime. It doesn't happen to a person who's been either tortured by the police or his family has been harassed or whatever other reasons. Radicalization is more dangerous if it happens out of a kind of a free will. You know, you genuinely feel that this is the path to salvation or whatever. So when that happens, your counter narrative is difficult. How can you have a counter narrative to tell him in theological terms that my route is better than yours and that what you're doing is wrong, particularly in a religion where supremacy is part of the theology, that my religion and nobody else's, my God and nobody else's. That is the tenets of Islam, basically, I think. So it's not easy to de-radicalize a person and say that I'll give him a new lesson, on give him a new job, a new way of life, and he will change. I think this is only a process that we have to go through. It's a process that has its own lifetime, and we hope that it will settle down at a different level later. I don't see any solution through economic terms or material terms or alternative theories. You can prevent radicalization if you have if you are depends on what is being taught to the small kids in schools and colleges and places of learning. Have you a check on that? Have you a control on that? How do you know what the child is being taught at home? You can have any kind of radicalization like that. You can have Hindu radicalization like that as well.
So, sir, it will be a very last question that I'll be asking you. So, at this time, do you watch movies these days?
No, the last one I watched was... No, I just watched an old film. I watched the Bourne Identity.
Oh, Bourne Identity. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Matt Damon.
Yeah. But the movie, have you seen The Bridge of Spies? Yeah. I've been to the Glenicke Bridge.
Oh, is it?
I went there 10 years ago. Yeah. Or less.
Yeah.
No,
the question was basically, we see a lot of spy movies that are made around India on the RNAW, sir. Is there a distant similarity which you have served as a tenure? You find a distant similarity?
Joking.
Ekta Tiger.
I would love to be Ekta Tiger though.
he got the ISI girl, sir.
Yeah. I was saying that this is the best part of the story.
But any of the stories that you've seen, at least a certain, a speck of similarity is there, or it's all the fascination?
It's all imagination run riot.
So now that you've retired, maybe some of the directors might have approached you to give them a certain sense of how the RNAW functioned to have a movie made. Has it happened anytime?
Madras Cafe is a good film otherwise.
Yeah, I thought there was a lot of...
There was, that was a well-made movie. and it was nicely done. That I should have mentioned that. And there is a hint of an RAW fellow there. Given the dramatics and the dramatic effects, I think it's a good movie.
All right.
So, the adrenaline rush that's there throughout the films, is it the same rush that you, an ordinary RAW officer, has throughout its day? Or it's just the cinematic aspect?
Not every day, not every day, but quite a few days. In your life can be, you know, can be quite tense and exciting. There is a feeling of anticipation. You know,
yeah.
For an intelligence officer, the best thing is when he gets a classical intelligence coup, top secret document or a top secret source gives you accurate information. It's a great feeling.
So lastly, sir,
because nobody else gives you credit. Only you can give it to yourself.
That's true. So lastly, sir, I just wanted to end by asking you this one question, that you have been inducted in the RAW since its very inception, and you have served for over 30 years. Especially, you know, you have been like the person who has seen the history of the entire organization, been in the entire organization. If you could summarize it the way, as much as you can see on the record, how has the organization changed over the years?
Starting from the leadership of Arun Kao, then, you know, followed by the other legends.
We had a very bad patch when Morarji Desai was the chief. He didn't like RAW at all. I mean, short of shutting it down, he did everything he could to slash it, to close operations, to shut down business, as it were. So it took a long time to recover from that. You know, you can destroy a thing very easily, but to rebuild takes a while. And then we had the unfortunate period of a strike by the staff. That was in the early 80s. Uske baad, then we had to claw our way back into the system. The performance has been good. We've always had a lot of the interactions with the government have been good, even excellent. So, and I'm told that the stock is still high. That's our only yardstick. We don't really go by what the media says or what anybody else says. As long as the government of the day feels it's relevant, it's relevant. Baki to log bolte rahenge.
Thank you so much, sir, by the way, for taking your time for this interview. Lastly, sir, this is one thing, a ritual thing with you, with all the speakers, and since you are now a seasoned author as well, any 5 books that you want our viewers to read?
On any topic? Or
any topic.
Any topic.
As per your wish, sir, if you want them to read on espionage, you can tell them as well.
Okay, now let me see. Do you have people read Narendra Singh Sirala's book?
No, sir.
The Cowboys?
No, no. The Untold Story of India's Partition. Narendra Singh Sirala.
Yes, sir. Or Bataiye?
No. Then another one related to this is War and Diplomacy in Kashmir by Chandrasekhar C. Dasgupta. Then if you want to read on espionage, Tim Weiner's book, Legacy of Ashes.
Wow.
It's about the CIA. You know, about the best book on Kim Philby is A Spy Among Friends.
That sounds interesting. Spy yeah. Among Friends.
By Ben McIntyre. Very nicely written book. Okay. Two more. The clash of barbarisms.
The clash.
It's by Gilbert Ashcar. A-S-A-C-H-C-A-R. Ashcar. Frenchman.
C-A-R.
And The Tyranny of Guilt. I think that's enough for your homework.
And of course, there are your books that are there as well.
Of course, they come on top.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking out your time and giving us the interview. It's a pleasure to speak to a former officer talking about the entire security issues that are going in the country, the fault lines, and a bit about the organization that you're all curious about to know. Maybe that's not well portrayed in the movies, but I think sir has really done a great job in telling us bits and parts, but making sure he keeps the secrecy to the organization and much anticipated conversation that we will have on YouTube probably. And we will all be excited to know more about it the next time we have a conversation with you again, sir.
Thank you. It was great talking to you, sir. Both of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Bye, sir.